Welcome to part two of Is Gotham Garage Really That Bad? There's just too much stuff to cover with only one video, so I figured I'd turn it into a bit of a series. Before we get into it, I just want to let you know about a giveaway that we're doing this month. There's going to be a video coming up near the end of the week that will have information. It's only for subscribers, so make sure to like and subscribe. Now let's get into some of the details about Gotham Garage. Since posting the first video, I had someone who worked on the show reach out to me and let me in on some of the behind the scenes information. Like, there are mechanics known as ghost mechanics that do a huge amount of the work on the builds, but aren't ever shown on screen. Also, there are several videos online showing the owner of the shop's home, with several of the sold builds parked in the driveway. Mark, the owner of Gotham Garage, was also said to have deliberately sabotaged work done by the ghost mechanics just to cause trouble and see if he could get them fired. Everyone who sees the show probably wonders whether or not it's fake, and I can confirm, for the most part, yes it is. Now let's have a look at some of the builds. The first car we're going to take a look at is a 1968 Plymouth Barracuda. Aside from the horrendous paint color and the terrible application, they painted everything on the car but the lights. I guess it saves time if you don't have to disassemble anything or do any masking. There's even a few spots where it looks like the paint bled through what little they did mask off. This car supposedly has a 360 V8 in it that makes 550 horsepower. They also put 100 shot of nitrous to this motor. Now, I don't know anything about the internals of the motor, but 550 is just about as far as you can push a 360. I'm not a Mopar fan myself, but it's terrible to see these people ruining a beautiful old muscle car. There's only so many of them left out there, and now there's one less. The one thing I did appreciate, though, was how the makers of the show only showed this car in the dark. I'm guessing that's just to hide all the terrible workmanship. There's not much good to say about this thing, and I'm pretty sure that's why you never actually get a good view of it. The next one we're going to have a look at is the 1969 Charger replica built from a 2013. But I'm going to let Mark tell you about it.
The rear wing just looks epic.
Bam! What? Bam! Made a spoiler for you, Doug.
Say, Ron, it's made out of hockey sticks and a piece of wood.
Yeah, but it's tight.
And it's 8 hours custom, man.
Saying you down?
Between that and the front nose, this car matches the aerodynamic look of the original car, 2AT. Based on where this car started, the transformation is just redonkulous.
Redonkulous, that's one way to describe it. Ridiculous, that's probably a better way to describe this thing. Like, to take that four-door car and make it a two-door, why would you bother? Why wouldn't you just go out and buy a Challenger and use the Challenger, put the nose cone on it, put the wing on it, and boom, there you go. You wouldn't have the structural issues, you wouldn't have any of the issues that these clowns ran into, but clearly they don't have half a brain between them all, otherwise that would have been the way to go. It seems like the builds just keep getting worse from season to season, but at least the editing's getting better and it's not showing near the amount of mistakes that they used to. One of the most glaring and obvious things is how they took two pieces of trim on that stretched door and put them together. They didn't even do a good job or make anything look good about it. The rear wing is bolted to the body, it's not wide enough for the car, and it looks absolutely terrible. There's not one good thing I can say about this thing. The way that they used Phillips head screws to screw on the friggin' trim, everything about it is just terrible. In my opinion, this is probably one of their worst builds. The wheel skirts, the fender flares, I mean, they don't even go all the way down on the bumper. You couldn't shape that last little bit? Come on now. This is absolutely terrible, and if you ever question whether or not it's real, how can this thing be worth $100,000+? It's just not possible. Next up is a Tesla Model S that the shop traded that 1968 Plymouth Barracuda for. There's a lot we can say about this Tesla, from the terrible two-tone paint job to what they did to the hood of this poor thing. This Tesla, with all the electric motors removed and a 383 strapped under the hood, is hideous. Mark actually stated they took a Tesla Model S and went total Gotham Garage on it. However, I think he meant Gotham Garbage. aside from all the crappy trim work and the fact that things are just screwed onto it, the hood isn't even, the gaps don't line up, probably the most cringeworthy moment of this whole episode was when Mark went to go fire the car up for the customer. The sound that came out of there is not something you want to hear when someone's asking $90,000 for a car. Let's have a listen.
Can you fire it up?
Oh, yeah.
Can you fire it up?
Am I going to need earplugs?
You're going to need them. The neighborhood's going to need them.
That belt squeal is one of the worst sounds you could ever hear coming from a car. It's not necessarily bad for the car, but it tells me that there's either belts not aligned properly, it's an old belt, or it's not tight enough. Something that any car guy should be able to fix relatively easily. But for some reason, these guys thought that was a great way to try to sell this car. The last car we're going to have a look at is a 1969 Chevelle. The shop built this one and decided they were going to ask $60,000 for it. They did a bunch of little custom features to it that they thought would make big money. For instance, shaved drip rails, the lowered stance, the big wheels, stuff like that. However, what they really did was they took a perfectly good Chevelle and made it terrible. Painting the chrome bumpers, cutting into the back bumper to put that rear diffuser in, just stupid choices over and over. The shaved drip rails are a good idea if it's executed properly, which clearly this was not. There's so many things bad about this car, and it's not even the worst one that they've done. My main gripe with it is the interior. They couldn't even center up the gauges. They put in these digital screens in there, and they're all off to the right side of the steering wheel. Like, who does that? You want your gauges right above the steering wheel where you can see them easily. You don't want them tucked in beside the steering wheel off to the side. That just doesn't look right. They said this thing has a full custom dash in it, but really all they did was put an aluminum plate in and called it good. They didn't even bother cleaning it. As you can see in the pictures of the interior, it looks terrible in there. It's dirty. There's just nothing good about any of these guys' builds. I also have to mention the fact that they used a JVC stereo in it. Now, JVC is not the worst brand you can buy, but it is not the best brand you can buy for a car stereo either. Typically, a JVC is something you pick up at Walmart, but they figured, hey, perfect for a $60,000 build. There's more cars that I could have mentioned in this video, but realistically, every car they build could be in this video. Now for what you all want to see.
Hardcore nudity!